Welcome to The Gig Show with Jim and Dan, where we discuss what it's like to play music, get noticed, and get paid to rock and roll in clubs and venues in and around Boston. I'm Jim Dorman.
And I'm Dan Cody.
And we are hosting The Gig Show, as with a lot of experience in the music business. I'm a correspondent for the Patriot Ledger for the last 21 years, and I haven't played any gigs, but I have been to a lot. But Dan has created a whole lot of music and played in a bunch of bands. So for this episode, he's not only going to be a host, but he's also our first guest. Welcome, Dan.
Thank you, Jim.
Dan was a member of Finger Lickin' Blue, Lead Society, The Highway Ghosts. He shared the stage with Foghat, Swingin' Stakes, The Fools, and many other well-known bands and musicians. He's currently in the red hot and local SPX band, the splendidly acoustic Matunic Road, mm-hmm. with friend Tom Hamilton from Weymouth, not the Aerosmith.
Correct.
Tom Hamilton. And most recently, Dan's a solo recording star.
Thank you.
You can check out at dancodymusic.com with a few EPs out or in the works. It's great stuff. You should check it out. And Dan's going to play a couple of his songs later on in the segment. So today we want to discuss what it's like to be a musician that gets paid to play gigs. And actually, did you know what gig is short for, Dan? I don't want to put you on the spot, but I had to look this up.
Sure, tell me.
Gig is short for engagement. Yeah. And I guess it was, according to what I've seen, is the jazz musicians in the 20s. That's what they said. We paid to play music. It's a gig.
Yeah.
And now, of course, it's extended this whole gig culture and those other things. But we're gonna stick to the music for right now. And I'm really interested in what it was like for you starting out. How you got to the point of actually playing your first gig. Can you kind of go back in time and tell us what that was like?
Yeah. It's a lot of getting to that first gig stage, which was a big goal for all of us, all my friends and all my bandmates. The goal was to get into a club or get into a venue that had a stage and maybe had a real sound system and maybe lights. But it all starts with family parties, mm-hmm. Playing in backyard parties and, maybe at like an Elks Hall and, different little rooms where you kind of start to get used to performing in front of people and kind of figure it all out. But the goal is to get to what we called a real club or a real stage.
So how old were you when that kind of stuff was happening?
So I was about 16.
And did you just play at these things? Did you actually get paid to play?
Sometimes we did. Family events, they'd always give us some money, or mm-hmm. Friends of friends, they'd pass the hat, whatever we could get. They weren't high paying gigs,
right?
But for us, it was just the thrill of doing it,
right?
Getting there, setting up, and starting to perform for the first time in front of a crowd or however many people were there.
When did you get to a point of having a band that you actually played in a club, and how did you get that gig?
Yeah, so there was a great club in Quincy. It was called the Yard Rock Cafe, and it was across from the Quincy Shipyard.
I remember it well.
Yep. And a guy by the name of Joe had taken it over and turned it into this, music club, big music fan. Mm-hmm. And, that was a very cool room to be at. I mean, he had Susan Tedeschi there, and this is in the beginning. And the Swingin' Stakes and all these great blues bands and kind of rock mm-hmm. bands. So we wanted to play there because it was the new place and it was the cool place to play, and that was the first gig for Finger Lickin' Blue. That was our very first performance.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe it was opening for the Swingin' Stakes, and there was a big
wow.
crowd, so we were all nervous.
Yeah.
But excited. But that was the very first official club.
Now, for those people who don't know, that's a pretty well-established band you're opening up for.
Yes, yes. The Swingin' Stakes, been friends with them for years.
Mm-hmm.
They were signed to Capricorn Records, a division of Warner Brothers. Mm-hmm. So, and they had toured with the band and a lot of different great acts opening for them. So they're our heroes at the time, still are, but you know, we really looked up to them.
How'd it go?
It went great.
It went great.
It was a packed house, and we had a great response, mm-hmm. and it was a great feeling. And that we knew then that, all right, we're going to keep, mm-hmm. we've got a band, it's a unit,
yeah,
we sound good, we get a good response. So that gave us the encouragement to keep going.
How do you know from the club owner, like, does the club owner give you any feedback? Do they invite you back, that kind of thing? How do you know afterwards?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, the first question after we were finished, hey, how did we do? What did you think? Hey, you guys did great. Really liked you. We'll have you back as an opening again. Yeah. You do that usually a couple times, and then you shoot to get a slot where you're the headliner.
Right.
But you have to usually go through a couple opening positions before you get the lead slot.
Now, I remember the Yard Rock very well. I'm glad mm-hmm. you brought that up. And yeah. I saw Susan Tedeschi. That can be a tight place.
Yeah, it was a small place. Yeah. It was a tight place, but it had a feel to it. It had a real club feel to me. Mm-hmm. You read about all the bands in the 60s and 70s, some of these great rooms like Max's, Kansas City, mm-hmm. These legendary rooms. That place had a feel to it. It felt like a music room. It didn't feel like a club or a restaurant that was having music. It felt like a music venue.
Right. And maybe you didn't know then, you know, what we know now is that Susan Tedeschi would go on to have her own great band.
Great success.
Marry Derek Trucks mm-hmm. from the Allman Brothers Band. And then go on to form their own band, the Tedeschi Trucks Band, that is doing quite well. One of the best bands out there.
Oh yeah, great band.
You know, right now.
We opened for Susan there at the Yard Rock. We used to go see her at the Hanover Mall food court. Mm-hmm. I mean, she was great right out the gate.
Right.
She had a fabulous band. She was fantastic. Yeah, we're all 16, you know, late teens, early 20s, and you know, just watching her is just pretty, pretty, pretty special.
And you see the progression with somebody like that, where now she plays a lot of lead guitar with her husband, who's obviously fantastic. That must be quite a tall order to do that. But back then, I think she was probably more on the rhythm side.
Yeah,
but, you know,
singer and rhythm.
Yeah, well, that's and makes me think of that back at the time you were Finger Looking Blue. What instrument were you playing?
I was actually on bass. So I started on drums when I was little, went to guitar.
Yeah.
For Finger Lickin' Blue, there was already two guitar players. We needed bass, so I picked up bass.
Wow.
Which I liked, I enjoy, so.
So you were kind of like the Paul McCartney of Finger Lickin' Blue, huh?
Yeah.
And
I guess you could say that.
Because I don't think he probably wanted to play the bass either, but he's one of the best bass players of all time.
Right.
What other, I think there was some other similarity with you and Mr. McCartney at the time. Do you know what I'm getting at?
Oh, my Hofner bass guitar.
Hofner bass guitar. Yeah. Your bass looked like Paul's early bass, too.
Exactly.
So you didn't even have to audition for that gig. Have you ever had an audition for a gig?
Yeah, some gigs we had to go down and, you know, play a couple songs in between sets of other bands that were already playing for the night. You know, we get up to two or three. A lot of times it was do you have a CD or, you know, a tape? Give me a few songs, let me listen, I'll give you a call. We always made good quality tapes or CDs, you know.
Yeah.
We always spent money to make quality recordings.
Right.
So as long as they heard something decent, you at least got a chance.
Mm-hmm.
You got a shot, hey, we'll give you an opening slot. If you can bring a crowd, we'll see how it goes. If you do good, we'll bring you back, and then eventually see if you can headline.
Okay. Yeah. Did you guys feel pressured to play any kind of music? I know you did do a lot of covers.
Yeah, we did a lot of covers. We didn't feel pressured. We played everything. We played mm-hmm. blues. We played rock. We played obscure album cuts. Rare stuff you don't really hear, but people liked it.
Right.
We just did what we liked.
Okay. Now, how many pieces in that band?
That was a 4-piece.
Oh, that's so you guys had just four guys, right?
Yep.
And how'd you guys, did stay four guys? Sometimes bands change over time. Did you get along well?
Yeah, that one was a good unit. It stayed 4-piece. We could have probably had a piano or a Hammond organ, but it just stayed as a 4-piece unit. We played well together. We worked well together.
Right.
It just didn't need to really expand it, so we kept it small.
Yep. And how long did that last?
Band went on for a good, probably 5 years.
And that was early 90s,
early
right?
Early 90s,
early
correct.
90s.
Yep.
So, speaking of gigs, obviously, maybe some of the better gigs that you guys got to play?
Yeah, we played in Megan's Place in Scituate Harbor.
Yeah.
We opened for Foghat.
Yeah.
And which was great about that, you know, at the time that you might not know who was in the band, but this was the original singer, well, the singer on the hits, Dave Peverett,
right,
Lonesome Dave, and the original drummer. So that was a big thrill, and they were great. But to hear him sing those songs, you've heard him on the radio, but to hear him live,
right,
you know, from the guy who did him was great. Yeah, Megan's Place was great. The Yard Rock, again, yeah, that was another big one.
Right. Well, let me stop you there, because Megan's Place is kind of a special, I think, situate or place for people, those of us who remember.
Yeah.
And it was kind of sometimes known more as the Bellboy, which was the restaurant that was upstairs.
Right.
And they had shows upstairs, but they also had a downstairs bar and venue, and as you said, Megan's Place was what it was called. I think it was the first place I ever saw a band.
Yeah.
And it did have that atmosphere. You went downstairs, it was smoky.
Yep.
Back then the admission age was less than it is now. I think,
right,
it was 18 to get in. Did you also like see other bands there? I mean, obviously you saw Foghat there.
Right. Yeah, they had a good, Megan's Place had a good lineup with a lot of those bands that were still touring, but you know, were maybe based in the 70s. So they would have Rick Danko come and play there. They had
from the band
Ginger Baker from Cream played there. I mean, so you know, they would get some pretty big names that would come through, and whenever we could, we'd try to get on an opening slot if we could, but. Yeah, we were there frequently to see some of these pretty big names that, you know, weren't doing much at the time, but they were still out there on the road, you know, still doing their songs.
Now, I was there that night.
Yep.
And saw you guys. You guys did great. And
yeah.
But, you know, I had never, I know a lot of my friends had seen Foghat before.
Mm-hmm.
And when they took that stage down there, first of all, I just couldn't believe it was Foghat,
yeah,
who had probably played, you know, some pretty large places.
Yeah.
In Boston and everywhere, you know, a big name in classic rock history, and but there was something about when they got on stage, the way they took the stage. I remember they all had like boots on, and they were kind of like really moving with like kind of fervor.
Yeah.
So it was really there was something about, I was really impressed with. They weren't just phoning it in this this little club in Scituate Harbor,
right,
you know. So I said that's what I picked up from it.
Yeah.
Do you remember anything like that, or you know, other things you saw from bands that maybe as a young musician you said, oh, well, that's pretty inspiring.
Yeah, you know, watching like you said, watching them, we played a lot with the Fools and the Swinging Stakes,
yeah,
and they were always, you know, you could tell they were giving it 150%, you know, even if they're doing the same songs, same set,
right,
you know, they did it with a passion. So, and that's what we learned. We played some gigs where there might have been two people,
yeah,
or no people,
right?
And you just say, all right, we still got to do, as you said, the engagement.
Right.
We're here. We're gonna do it. We're gonna play our best. If there's 100 people, great. If there's two people, we're still going to give it our all. Mm-hmm. And that's what we learned from a lot of those bands. So you got to, to your point, you can't phone it in.
Yeah.
you got to give it your all.
Oh. What do you think the biggest show you got to do was?
Yeah, that Far Cat one was pretty big. That was a good show. A lot of favorite shows at the Beachcomber in Quincy, on Wallston.
Another great venue,
Wallston Beach. You know, with the fools would pack them in, and you know, we always enjoyed opening for them because they had a big crowd.
Yeah.
So when we got on stage, we already had a full house. So that was incentive to, again, let's really give it our best,
right,
to impress these people and show that, you know, we're not kids, we're not, you know, just goofing around here. You
right.
know, we've got something to bring to the table. But those were always big gigs to, you know, I think back about uh-huh. a lot of fun memories of opening for those guys.
Well, you mentioned the Fools, and that they're known for kind of fooling around a little bit.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Even their name is kind of like that, but I bet you they're serious about their fooling around. They knew what they were doing.
Yeah, they're professionals, they're consummate pros.
Yeah.
And you know, they opened for Van Halen on Van Halen's first album, first or second tour. They were the opening act for quite a number of shows. So that's pretty big spot to make it to.
Did you get to know any of those guys at all?
Oh yeah,
are they all local guys?
Yeah, yep, good friends now, and you know, we played with them for years, so learned a lot from them.
What's their big song?
Well, Tonight for Beautiful Girls was the big hit in 1979.
That's the one I remember.
Yeah, World Dance Party.
Yeah,
Life Sucks, Then You Die. Yeah.
Well, I have to interject a little. I had a little story from when I was my first office job that I worked at in Boston at the New England Telephone Company. Mm-hmm. I had went out to Strawberry's Records and had a big LP of the Pretenders under my arm, and the big boss, John Bartlett,
yep.
who you know, you kind of like, he's like the guy in the corner, and there were probably like 50 people out on the floor, and I was the college, like, not even intern, just, you know, summer help guy. He gets on the elevator and he sees my Pretenders album. He goes, oh, they're good. But I like the Fools. And I said, yeah, I like the Fools too. And he just didn't say anything. I found out later that his son Rich was the one of the guitarists, the lead guitarist yeah. in the Fools. So,
that's right.
So that was just great. So actually I was had tickets to see the Fools Saturday night. Well, depending on when this airs, what you see, but it would be this Saturday night. And unfortunately, it was up on the, I think in Beverly, yeah. And they postponed it a while back, oh. I think, due to COVID yeah. restrictions or something like that. So hopefully they can reschedule and be looking forward to hearing it.
Yeah.
Night for Beautiful Girls.
Yeah, they're still great.
Again.
Go see them if you can.
Okay. Well, you know, we got a few more minutes to talk, but I know we want to also break for a few songs or that you want to play. You got some new stuff, and one of the songs on your latest EP mm-hmm. is Out of the Blue, right? From Long Distance Line. So
yeah.
We're going to take a little break, and Dan is going to play Out of the Blue from his EP, Long Distance Line.
Sometimes your dreams get washed away. Sometimes you save them for a rainy day. Sometimes it feels like they'll never come. Feels like you're always watching the setting sun. Come true, it can happen to you. You gotta have faith and see it through. Yeah, dreams come true, can happen to you. You gotta believe and see them through. You've got to keep on dreaming, yeah. You've got to keep on dreaming, yeah. You've got to keep on dreaming all the time. Some days you feel like you're all alone. Some days you give it thought, but they're on your own. Don't let anybody get in your way. Keep on dreaming, save it for today. Dreams come true, it can happen to you. You gotta have faith and see it through. Yeah, dreams come true, it can happen to you. You gotta believe and see them through. You've got to keep on dreaming, yeah. You've got to keep on dreaming, yeah. You've got to keep on dreaming all the time. Come. Some days you're sitting there watching the setting sun. Don't let anybody get in your way. Keep on dreaming and do it every day. Come true, it can happen to you. You gotta believe and see it through. Yeah, dreams come true, it can happen to you. You gotta believe and see it true. Yeah, dreams come true, it can happen to you. You gotta believe and see them through. Yeah, dreams come true, it can happen to you. You gotta believe, see it true. You've got to keep on dreaming, yeah. You've got to keep on dreaming, yeah. You've got to keep on dreaming all the time.
Welcome back, Dan. That was fantastic performance. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
We'll get back to our conversation on some of the bands and clubs and gigs around the South Shore of Boston. Mm-hmm. And so one of the things, now we'll definitely talk a little bit more about some of your bands. I'd love to do that. But who are some of the local bands that that you remember that did really well and that maybe you wanted to kind of emulate? We have a little different eras. I don't know if anybody could tell. I might be a couple of years older than you, but so I have some of mine that I know. But is there any bands that you remember that you know were like, oh boy, they are good. We'd like to be as good as they are or have the same kind of response.
Yeah, in addition to the Swingin' Stakes, right, they had an offshoot band that was called Weed, which was a four-piece band.
Oh, okay.
And it was obviously some of the Swingin' Stakes, but it was a great kind of offshoot band that we've loved, we looked up to, and a little bit more on the kind of the rock side, not so much country rock.
Okay.
That was a big thrill. We liked to see that different side of, okay, You don't want to just be labeling yourself country rock all the time.
Mm-hmm.
So that kind of spurred on Highway Ghosts to kind of come into that realm of, you know, let's have some elements of country, but it's that Americana is where we really fell under, which is can be a broad range, you know. So it can be rock, it can be get into some of the Grateful Dead area where you kind of jam and expand on songs rather than just playing 3 minutes every song.
That's an interesting progression that you got, you and how many people were in both Finger Lickin' Blue and
Highway Ghost? Highway was four as well.
We're in both the same band.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. And on recordings, you know, we expanded to, it would include piano and Hammond organ with Highway Ghost, pedal steel, you know, we'd have people play on the recordings to really expand the songs. Mm-hmm. But as a live unit, you know, it was still a four-piece. Occasionally, we'd have Jimmy Gambino from the Stakes, Swingin' Stakes, would play with us. So he'd play keyboard. So that was a great thrill.
So tell us a little bit about how that, you know, that band got a little bit of notice.
They absolutely got great notice with, some big write-ups, Cream Magazine. Talking about them kind of carrying on the tradition of the Eagles, what the Eagles had started, and that I think they were kind of identified as the best country rock band to come out of Boston since Graham Parsons' International Submarine Band, which was the beginnings of what would become the Byrds' kind of country lineup, Sweetheart of the Rodeo era.
Fantastic.
So, you know, learning a lot about that whole scene and era. So, you know, we learned from them in their recordings of, you know, how to really get into the songwriting art and really craft, you know, songs. And, you know, with Highway Ghost, we made two really good albums.
Yeah.
They came out really good, really well produced and recorded and well written. And that's what we were able to learn from them.
Yeah. I don't know if this was a big gig or not, but I know at one point you guys played like outside Gillette. Is that?
Yeah, Gillette Stadium. Yeah, that was a fun gig. It was a hot day, but it was great. You know, so we played Gillette Stadium.
Okay, you played Gillette Stadium. You can always say that. That's fantastic. Were you playing bass again or guitar now?
I was on bass.
You were on bass.
Yeah.
You're still I don't know if you're frustrated playing the bass because I'm sure you.
No, I love playing bass too. I love them both. I love drums as well. So I'm at home playing guitar, but if I have to play bass, I love playing it too. So wherever I end up, I'm happy to play.
So how do you sort it out? Like kind of say like now you're in a big band, the SPX band, and there's how many pieces?
That
depends.
Yeah, it depends on the day and the gig.
Yeah.
It could be 9 or 10. It could be 5. Could be 4. It's a collective. Many of us have known each other for 20 plus years, if not 30 plus years, in some cases. And we love playing. Just making people have fun. People get up and dance. You know, sing along, join in with us. So you know, still bringing music to the people.
Yeah, and that's the current project. You guys do mostly covers, throwing a few originals once in a while, right?
Yep, occasionally, but it's pretty much a cover band, fun kind of party band. And
and where do you guys get gigs?
Primarily right now, we're in and around Weymouth, the cottage. We pick up other functions and events, private parties. But kind of staying in the Weymouth area is kind of the home home base.
Everybody in the band has ties to Weymouth, I think, right?
Yes.
So not too far down the piece from here in Abington, where we're filming today. But obviously, you guys haven't been able to. You know, I think there was a kind of a thing going on where you guys played every first Sunday of the month at the Cottage Bar in Columbian Square, South Weymouth, Great Irish Bar.
Yeah.
For how long has it been since you've been able to do that?
So when COVID hit and we all went on lockdown, it ended up being few months back, we just did our first gig in 17 months.
Right.
So that was quite a long layoff. And you kind of had to dust everything off and get back to playing these songs again.
What was the first gig?
Back at the cottage.
Yeah, okay.
Yep.
Back at the cottage. I know you guys did some food truck events, which outside a little better given COVID conditions. Where were some of those this last summer?
Yeah, that was the Weymouth 400 celebration. We did the food truck rodeo at the old South Weymouth High School.
Yeah.
And then we just recently did another Weymouth 400 celebration behind the Tufts Library.
Yeah. Now, did you have to practice much to get back in the swing of things?
No, funny enough, we did one practice, and we played the next week.
Really?
And all of a sudden,
consummate professionals.
Yeah, all of a sudden it clicked, and it's like riding a bike, you know? Once you do it, you never forget, you just gotta put the pieces together.
Yeah. Well, as you know, as those of us who have seen it and been allowed to participate, I'm lucky enough to get able to join for a song or two. What a great group of people to let me do that and let other people do that and make it kind of work.
Yeah.
But I mean, I've seen you guys with, speaking of bass players, even two bass players.
Yep.
Occasionally. And backup singers and the whole thing. They're almost like the Tedeschi Trucks Band or Mad Dogs and Englishmen of Weymouth.
Yeah, yeah. And it all goes back to the beginning question. You know, it all starts in those family parties,
right.
You know, functions, after wedding parties. And, you know, that's where we knew we loved music, and then we got to play in front of people. We knew we loved that.
Right.
And that's why we're still doing it 30 odd years later.
Wow.
And we want to inspire other people like yourself to come up and play and join in and do your little bit.
It's amazing.
Music's fun. It should be.
Yeah. And it makes people happy.
It does.
Whether it's a sad song or not.
Right.
And more recently, you know, after being in all these bands, you've made the effort, not that you just had the time, but I think you made the effort to start doing some of your own music. What inspired that?
Yeah, for years with all these bands, you know, we always did a lot of covers, but we would also write our own music. And I would have been writing since I was 16. And I listened to a lot of different music, so I write a lot of different music. And a lot of it didn't necessarily fit the band I was in at that time.
Right.
So I kind of piled up all these songs, and I keep writing new ones. So I just said, now's the time to put these songs to the test, record them, see how good I can make them, and see if they're worth releasing. And I feel pretty confident that, you know, with this EP, you know, and the new stuff coming out, that I've been able to put some pretty good things together, and people seem to be enjoying it. So it was just time to get some of this old music and new music out.
Yeah.
As my on my own solo.
And did you play most of the instruments yourself on it, or who did you work with?
Yeah, a lot of them myself. Joe Clapp produced the music for. He's in Hanover, Massachusetts, at Ultrasound Productions Studio.
Right.
Great producer. Great setup.
Yeah.
So he's on it. Dennis Barry from Highway Ghosts and Finger Lickin' Blue.
Oh.
Dave DeLuca. You know, a lot of my friends joining in on different songs. Gary Ticini, who was original Finger Lickin' Blue, doing a lot of keyboard work. So it's mainly Joe and I putting them together, and then we bring in friends to really embellish.
Well, I can tell people that the music is, it's very, you know, upbeat, and you know, things about just staying positive and songs about love and just the whole journey of life with some really cool, like Beatles-esque type of music in some cases, or maybe, you know, some inspired by some of the people I think that you were inspired by, which is the way I think music works.
Yeah, I wear my influences on my sleeves. The Beatles, Tom Petty, the Rolling Stones, you know, the big ones. You know, I'm not afraid to, you know, show what I was brought up on with my older sister and brothers.
Right.
All their great albums that they schooled me on is kind of led me to where we are now. Yeah. So,
you know, you mentioned that I'm the youngest of my family, and I think you're the youngest.
I'm the youngest.
You're the youngest. Yeah. And I had older brothers that, you know, some of them really were into music. Everybody was kind of into music, and yeah. I think that was just such a great thing. And I notice it in people, you know, my own age, that either their knowledge of music might be based on whether they had any older siblings. You know,
correct.
There was such a great thing to have a brother 5 years older than me that had musician friends and playing, you know, when I was 10, listening to the Allman Brothers or the Grateful Dead or Rolling Stones or, you know, whatever they might have had. You know, I was going to try to make myself listen to it and understand it to the best I could, and just you know, gain that musical knowledge. Whereas I might, you know, mention a band or something to someone who's my age, but they didn't have any older siblings, and they'd be like, I know, you know, I don't want to make fun of anybody, but you know what, they might have known more of the pop type of songs and things. Anyway, so I think that there's something to that. I've always
That's a foundation and family. My grandfather was a drummer. My dad played banjo, so growing up he was always, you know, at parties or St. Patrick's Day playing the banjo, singing the songs. So that foundation of family influence combined with all these Bob Dylan, Pink Floyd, The Beatles, The Who, you name it, hearing that as a young, real young child just gave me the foundation to get to hear.
Well, again, you know, I know what the age difference is between us, and you know the music, you know, that came before you, and I think that I don't know, it seems to me that's always a recipe for a successful either music lover like myself or a music maker.
You gotta know where it all starts from and where it came from.
And then put your own stamp on it and bring it forward. So
absolutely.
Well, I think that's about, you know, about as much as you probably wanna cover today. I wanna thank you so much, Dan Cody, for being our first guest on the Gig Show, and hopefully we can have we'll bring in some more people to talk to for our next show. So we thank you for joining us on the Gig Show with Jim and Dan, and we hope you'll join us next time for more stories from the stage. Please like, share, and subscribe to our podcast. We're working on our social media presence, so look for us soon in all the popular places. You can listen to Dan's new solo work at dancodymusic.com. Did I say that Boston enough? .com?
.com.
And at all the music sharing services. Thanks and keep rocking. We'll see you the next time on the Gig Show with Jim and Dan. And Dan is going to play us out with, I believe, a cover of John Sebastian. Stories We Could Tell.
Yep, Stories We Could Tell. It's a great song. I thought it'd be fitting for this first podcast and taping the show to play a song that really hits home to exactly what we're talking about, gigs and the whole process of getting out there and playing music in front of people. So we'll hear that song.
It's a great song. I had to go back and you told me you were going to play it. And Loved John Sebastian and Tom Petty.
Yep.
Jimmy Buffett did it as well. Anyway, so thank you for coming and listening and watching The Gig Show with Jim and Dan.
All right, here's a song written by John Sebastian called The Stories We Could Tell. Talking to myself again, wondering if this traveling is good. Is there something better doing we'd be doing if we could? And oh, the stories we could tell. And if this all blows up and goes to hell, I can still see us sitting on a bed in some motel, listening to the stories we could tell. Yeah. remember that guitar in that museum in Tennessee. The name played on the glass brought back 20 melodies. And the scratches on the face told of all the times he fell, singing every story he could tell. And oh, the stories we could tell. I bet you it still rings like a bell. I can still see us sitting on a bed in some motel. Listen to the stories we could tell. So if you're on the road, trucking down here every night, singing for a living neath the brightly colored lights. And if you ever wonder why you ride this carousel, you did it for the stories you could tell. And oh, the stories we could tell. And if this all blows up and goes to hell, I can still see us sitting on a bed in some motel, listening to the stories we could tell. Yeah, I can still see us sitting on a bed in some motel, listening to the stories we could tell.